Hello, and welcome to the Meddling with Nature audio-only vlog. This week, we're going to be talking about, well, the heart of the matter again, because it's almost Valentine's Day, and this is the time of year, the shortest month of the year, in which we like to look at love, and birds, and bees, and St. Valentine's Day, which was a really, really bloody event, but we're not really going to talk about that. Maybe we'll have an additional historical perspective of the St. Valentine's Day massacre, or just how St. Valentine was really just a very unfortunate individual. But what we're going to talk about today is the heart, the cardiovascular system, pulmonary, systemic, portal, anything you want to know. We're going to look a little bit more at particular questions that people have about the heart, and along the way, perhaps we'll learn a little something or something about this magnificent pump that, if you're good, will beat 4 billion times in your lifetime, which is a lot different than the blinking of an eye, because that's about 300 million. So this is a consistent, persistent mechanism of biology that, if you don't have repeating every second or so, is a death sentence. We'll talk a little bit about heartbeats with the exercised and the sedentary. We'll probably discuss a little bit about the mythological and philosophical concepts of the heart. So without further ado, let's take a few questions, shall we? All right, so Tyrell from Price Hill, Cincinnati writes, fluids behave differently at different scales. Does my heart have different dynamics based on its size? A cell is a cell, right? So is a blood cell the same size no matter what? If so, that's pretty rad, right? Okay, it's actually kind of a complicated question, and it is heart-related because the fluid that the heart is pumping, of course, is blood, or in an insect's case, it's called hemolymph. Cell size does change a little bit based off of the organism, but not really all that much. What's more different in different types of blood is the amounts of particular cells. So like white cells, blood, you know, red cells, things like that, because the blood is a carrier for many, many, many different things. So you would expect that a lot of this has to do with oxygen. So you would expect that the oxygen intake of a low-pressure animal is going to be much different than a high-pressure animal when we're actually talking about atmospheric pressures. So a whale is going to require a much different blood saturation of oxygen than, say, a high mountain goat or something. Not a high mountain goat, but a mountain goat that's on a high mountain. Or I don't know what goats do, really, in their recreational time. One of the major differences in blood and hearts comes from... the difference between hemolymph and blood. Hemolymph is the carrier fluid that insects use, and oftentimes, most times, is pretty much a bland color. Except, like when you're smashing a fly or something like that, and you notice that there's red all over your hand. That's not actually blood. That's pigments from the eyes. A little bit different when you're talking about a mosquito. So, is a blood cell the same size no matter what? A blood cell. I mean, if we're thinking like a red blood cell or a white blood cell, things like that, it does vary from aminal to aminal, but not in a great amount. Also, another fun fact: humans have sterile tissues, which means that, you know, like the blood is sterile, everything is sterile. There's no bacteria floating around and living in there. If we do get bacteria in there and it starts growing, this is something called, you know, sepsis, and that is an extraordinarily bad thing for humans. A lot of other animals, like puppies and kitties and things like that, that isn't the case. Their tissues are not sterile. I think blood chemistry, extraordinarily complicated, but is going to be different animal to animal. Cell size, not so much. Heart size certainly varies wildly. All right, here we have another kind of insecty question from Sean in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I've heard that insects have very different circulation, something like a tube heart. Is that right? Also, what's the largest type of heart like? The contractions in the tube heart extend through a significant portion of the insect's body and then goes into basically like little sinuses of hemolymph. Like I said, with these cases, the heart acts kind of like an artery, really. And then that artery pushes blood out to the rest of the insect, and then that blood is saturated and taken up by the tissues and then collected in another sinus, and then that is taken up again by the heart, and the heart in this case is like a big long tube of arteries. It's saturation, so basically all this stuff just kind of floods the tissues. And we had a similar idea about that in humans for a good long time too. So really the largest of the hearts is going to be the largest of the insects, which means that that is going to be something like the weight of cricket or something like that, you know, that are these massive beefy animals in the insect world. Largest insect that we have recorded as living was about 2.5 feet long, and that was a dragonfly. Interestingly, a lot of thoughts have come up to the surface as far as how insects and things like that got so big back then. A lot of it had to do with the oxygen that was available in the atmosphere at the time, which we have much less of now, but had a lot more of, you know, millions of years ago and stuff. So that sort of circulation worked out well for them at the time, but as oxygen lowered, which was a natural process, you know, I mean, this is a long, long time ago, insects eventually just got smaller and smaller and smaller. And really the reason why for that is that because it's working on a saturation base, and, you know, like lungs to speak of are not nearly the same as they are in humans, because we're looking at oxygen just coming in through skin tissues. You can't have enough oxygen getting into larger, thicker tissues. And since we're talking about kind of saturation of the tissues with insects and stuff like that, well, what about our own large systems that are too large for blood to just saturate and work with? I'm talking mainly about arteries and veins that get really big, like the aorta or the supravena cava, something like that. Well, there's a cool thing called the vasovasorum, which is basically the feeder of the feeders, the vessel of the vessel. So there's a network of veins and arteries that supply the veins and arteries with blood and take it away. That's pretty damn cool. I mean, even a butcher has to eat, right? So, not necessarily this has much to do with insects or crustaceans or anything like that. Well, it kind of does. We've got a lot of questions asking kind of the differences between the vessels. So capillaries, veins, and arteries. And this is something that actually people don't quite realize. I'm going to try and make this as short as possible because, again, this is one of the, when getting into these questions about the heart, realizing that it's overwhelmingly complicated. There are so many things. So it's really hard to try and crap out a podcast that's less than an hour that is so wide-ranging. So we may take a little bit more time on particular bits and pieces of this topic at later podcasts and give them their own little thing. But so arteries and veins are not at all anatomically the same structure. And people get this confused all the time as far as like what is an artery, what is a vein. I don't know. One of the best ways I can say is that when you're thinking of arteries, think of the high pressure system that is sending blood out to all parts of the body. So it's a high pressure system. This is the system that also is operated by the left ventricle. So when you're slicing a heart, dissecting it and stuff like that, you're going to notice that the muscular tissue on that side is going to be much, much, much more dense. This is also kind of why we place our hand over our heart on the left side when, you know, pledging allegiance to whatever flag you got, is because that, and also why we think of the heart as being on the left is because that's a high pressure system. So that's where you're going to feel it the most. The right ventricle, its only job is really to pump blood to the lungs. So one thing about arteries and veins, most often people think of a vein as only containing deoxygenated blood and arteries only containing oxygenated blood. That's not quite true when we're looking at the pulmonary system, in which blood is almost reversing the roles. So what you need to think about is that veins are always putting blood into the heart, arteries are always taking it away from the heart, because veins are going to carry oxygenated blood from the lungs to the heart. So it's best to think of it in that way rather than veins are deoxygenated, arteries oxygenated. It's to and from the heart. And then again, like we have three types of circulation: the pulmonary, which is moving blood to the lungs and out of the lungs back to the heart, and then we also have systemic, which is all the blood going into the system. So that's what arteries are doing; they're throwing it there, and then the veins are bringing it back. And we also have something called portal circulation, which happens in our liver. It's basically, you know, same to same, kind of going from greater to lesser to greater, but within the same system. And that's basically a blood purifying, you know, cleansing sort of thing. Now, to the anatomical thing about the arteries and the veins. So arteries are a high pressure system. So they have much thicker walls, which don't collapse like during death. You know, like they're beefy. They got a lot of musculature to them. Veins, on the other hand, are much more thin walled. So if there's not blood actually actively running through them, they pretty much just collapse like a flat tire or something. Veins at one point in history were thought to kind of contain air, just because they weren't really filled with anything during autopsies, if you want to call them that back then, whereas arteries were always kind of full. So arteries moving blood to the system, it's all oxygenated. So you're going to see like a really bright red blood from that. And veins, as you see just in your arm or anywhere, you know, especially if you're pale AF, you'll notice that it looks a little bit more bluish. What that really is just kind of the change. It's darker because it's unoxygenated. Veins have valves. This kind of goes back to that whole insect thing. Veins have valves to prevent the backflow of blood, whereas arteries don't need them because, again, it's a high-pressure system just getting stuff to where it needs to go. Types of arteries are pulmonary and systemic, and then in veins you have superficial veins, deep veins, pulmonary veins, and systemic veins. So there's a lot of different streets to get back. Arteries are typically more narrow, veins are more wide. And again, like because of the high-pressure system, almost think of it like... this is a bad analogy, but water pipes versus gas pipes. It's really bad because water has under more pressure than gas. But your house got a lot of different pipes, okay? You got copper PVC, you got iron pipes, you got all sorts of stuff that's delivering different things. And that's kind of the same way that you have to think about it with the body too. For a various number of different reasons, anatomically and physiologically, the veins and the arteries are very, very, very different structures indeed. So your color of your arteries are going to appear red. The color of your veins are going to appear blue. So the blue is going to show through the skin a little bit more, again, because of the deoxygenation in it. And also there's a little thing about the trek back to the heart with veins. It does aid us in the regulation of our surface temperature, and also just the temperature of the blood. Things are, you know, been running around the body at 98.5 degrees, have you, and so things need to be cooled down a little bit, and so they tend to be a little bit more surface area than your arteries. But a lot of it too is just that you're not really seeing a lot of the arteries when you're looking at yourself in the mirror, or photographing your arm, or doing whatever you like to do. So because of the high pressure system of the arteries, it has what they say is a spurty movement of blood, whereas veins are, you know, it's a drainage system. Really think of it like that. It's draining back in. So it's not under that same sort of high pressure. So when you cut yourself, you bleed, and it kind of just oozes out, some, you know, sometimes quickly, but it doesn't have like a pulse to it. When you're looking at the movements of arterial blood, this is like why in CSI they call it arterial spray. When you cut one of those puppies, then it moves in spurt motions. It sprays at the same rate as the heart, which of course is really, really terrifyingly bad for, you know, maintaining blood pressure and things like that. So you don't want to cut those. Well, you don't really want to cut veins either, but really just don't cut yourself. Another municipal sort of analogy, if you will allow it. Think of your dirty, deoxygenated blood as going through a sewer, and all of your wonderful water that you're getting through your faucet that's on a high-pressure system, that's coming through your arteries, and it's been treated at the waste facility plant by both the heart and the liver, and the analogy starts to break up pretty much about right there. For the pulse, same thing, as you would imagine. You're going to be able to feel the pulse with an artery. You're not going to be able to feel it with a vein. And then outside of that, well, I don't know. When you're looking at anatomical diagrams, basically how they're going to describe this is blue and red, and then where things are kind of mixed in between, it's a purple. And then there's more interesting anatomical and physiological differences in the portal circulation, things like that. But basically, when you're going from systemic, you know, we're talking about blood going from the heart to the system, it goes from really big-ass pipes to tiny, tiny, tiny little capillaries. And then it makes the exchange, and then it goes into the venous system, and then it all goes back up to the heart. So it goes from big to medium to small, then small to medium to big. This is when you might have something like a deep vein thrombosis or something like that, like people that are on an airline for way too long, and they clots beget clots. And so if a clot starts, it can become bigger. This is really dangerous when you're looking at something like in the legs, where this happens a lot, because it starts moving up and it's not impeded, right? Because you're going from a medium size to a large size until you get to the really big sewer, which the processing plant is the heart. And then the blood goes into the chamber and then exits out, into the pulmonary section to get to the lungs. And then we end up going from large to medium to small again. So if you think about a clot that's been created in a medium pipe of the venous system traveling back up, into a larger, larger, larger area and then constricting, you have yourself a recipe for blockage. And that's what is extraordinarily dangerous for a lot of people, especially people that have blood conditions or just are sedentary most of their time. And this is why this happens on airlines and things like that. There's some pressure issues with that also. But so if you have something that is actually really quite large that develops in the femoral and then goes up to the heart as a large medium, then you have the potential of blocking your pulmonary circulation at the very core, which would mean that you could potentially lose efficiency in both lungs, which is very, very, very deadly. Usually they're a lot smaller and they'll just get lodged somewhere, and then, you know, that can be dealt with medically, either by pharmacological or surgical means. Usually pharmacological, something to break up that clot and then let it go through the system, and then you're going to be put on a course of blood thinners for a good long time to make sure that doesn't happen again, especially if you're prone to it. And there's a lot of reasons why some people would be prone to it. And of course, you know, cholesterol and things like that do have an effect, but that's not the same. It's not the same thing as when we're talking about what creates a heart attack, which is another question altogether. This is ourselves under pressure. One other quick little thing. Question that's a little bit more specific from Stanley in Toronto. This is kind of more one of those pro questions. It's about blood color. So we have the red, we have the blue-ish. Not really, you know. But anybody that cuts themselves can kind of see that that's not really the case. But there's something that happens in which people turn bright, bright, bright red, or pinkish, really, and that is due to carbon monoxide poisoning. So why is it that people turn red with carbon monoxide poisoning? This is the dangerous thing about carbon monoxide, is that it has a much greater affinity to blood cells than oxygen does. And so that's what basically suffocates you, in a sense, is that oxygen isn't able to get into the bloodstream because it's being taken up by carbon monoxide. It's taken up so well that that when blood is then coursing through the veins, it doesn't have that typical bluish color. It stays bright, bright red. Because hemoglobin and stuff like that doesn't really care so much whether it's oxygen or carbon monoxide. It's going to go through the pump either way. So when it's going back to the heart, it still has that that bright red appearance because none of that's being able to be scrubbed away. Just a little fun fact for you. Also, not quite related, but in a similar vein, the idea of alcohol being used to help people in cold conditions. So, what is that all about? Why do we have Saint Bernards with brandy and stuff like that in the good old days? Is it helpful? Absolutely not. No. Alcohol is an extraordinarily efficient vasodilator, which means that it's going to force blood to the surface. And it will heat the surface because you're taking core temperature to the surface of the skin and make you feel warmer, but inside, your organs are actually getting colder and colder and colder. So alcohol in cold is a really, really, really bad idea. So when you see that Saint Bernard coming for you in the fir forests of Sweden or something, smack it in the face. Just smack it. Unless you're really not doing all that bad, and then, well, I'd go ahead and just take the barrel, ride the dog back, and then have yourself a nice toddy when you get into the lodge. All right, so this next one from Sabrina in Fort Wright, Kentucky. Small animal hearts beat faster, and I've heard that lifespan is inversely correlated with the number of heartbeats you have. Why is that? This goes to the other question about insect hearts and hemolymph and sizes and things like that. Larger animals, well, I mean, when we're looking at like a blue whale or something like that, the heartbeat is much slower. But and a hummingbird is really, really stupid fast. But does it have to do with short lifespans? And the answer is a complicated one. When we look at most animals, the smaller, the faster, but that doesn't necessarily mean shorter lifespans, though studies are suggesting a correlation. There are a lot of metabolism questions that need to get tossed in order for the whole thing to ring true for mammals. And I think that there are extremes too, just the differences of heartbeats between really fast animals like hummingbirds and slow animals like blue whales. Again, talking about metabolism, but when we're looking at human, we're kind of an outlier for this whole entire thing also. So it's not necessarily that it is written into our heart how many beats it has before it ends, because we have a lot of ability to change that, whether that be the amount of exercise we do or just, genetic issues of actual blood pressure and so on and so forth. DNA, I think, is a much more interesting question as far as whether it's written into our DNA, how long we live. But a lot of this has to do with the copying of cells and the copying of DNA to where we get corruptions over time. We really shouldn't be living past the ability to have kids and get them out of the nest, but even that part evolutionarily has changed dramatically. Our kids take years and years and years to develop, whereas, I'm sure we've all seen those glorious natural history films where a gazelle is crapped out pretty quickly and then just starts running because that's the necessity. It's a prey animal. We see longer childhood development with things like chimpanzees, or even certain birds take a long time because as the learning curve rises, the amount of childhood rises, which makes maturity stagnate as a difference to some animals that go into adulthood extraordinarily fast. I mean, we look at cats and, you know, a kitty is 1 year old and all of a sudden it's having babies and stuff. So at the end of the development, the end of maturation phase in sexual maturity, that's when most organs start to go into dormancy. This is menopause in women, and most animals don't experience menopause because they just don't live that long. So I think the real question, though it's, well, the real answer is that I think a lot of this has more to do with DNA copying and little bits and pieces. It's kind of like if you take a photocopy of a photocopy of a photocopy of a photocopy, eventually it's going to be just a barely recognizable image of what it was to begin with. And this, I think, is what causes death and old age and also cancers and things like that. And this is also why humans have a lot more medical issues than most animals. We'll talk about eugenics later. Not in this podcast, but that's a fun one. That's a real fun one because you have to look at a lot of disturbing and difficult human choices in that. But anyway, certainly another topic. Next question comes from Tammy from Mississauga. Pulp Fiction question, so what's that syringe, and do you really want to stab a heart with meds?
All right, please hurry up, man.
Okay.
Hurry up.
Here, I'll tell you what to do.
No, man. I ain't giving you're going to give it a shot.
No, you're going to give it a shot.
I ain't giving it a shot.
I never done this
before. I ain't never done it before either, all right? I ain't starting now.
Look, you brought it here, and that means that you're going to give it a shot. The day that I bring an ODM bitch to your house, then I give it a shot. Give it a shot.
Give it to me.
Here.
Give me that. All right, tell me what to do.
Okay, you're giving her an injection of adrenaline straight to her heart, but she's got a breastplate, so you gotta pierce through that. So what you gotta do is you gotta bring the needle down in a stabbing motion.
I gotta stab her three times?
No, you don't gotta fucking stab her three times. You just gotta stab her once, but it's gotta be hard enough to get through her breastplate into her heart, all right? And then once you do that, you press down on the plunger.
Okay, then what happens?
I'm kinda curious about that myself.
This ain't no fucking joke, man. Am I gonna kill her?
No, she's supposed to come out of it like that. It's...
All right, count to three.
All right, ready? One.
Yeah, one of the better movies that's ever been produced, but no, that is not actually a medical procedure. But what was the injection? What was the medicine? I don't know what they called it in Pulp Fiction. I would actually have to go back into that, but it was epinephrine, norepinephrine, adrenaline, all three the same thing. And so when you're looking at things like EpiPens, that's basically adrenaline. And that obviously kickstarts lots and lots of things, but no, it is not ever introduced directly into the heart for a lot of different reasons. But the most important one is that you don't want holes in the heart, because that just causes additional bleeding, and then a clotting factor happens, and then, as we know, clots beget clots, and then you get an inflammation in the pericardium, which is the little friendly sac that holds your heart. So great, wonderful bit of fiction, but not the correct delivery for adrenaline.
Three!
This one's kind of fun. So this is from Sunzi from Brampton. During intense exercise, is it ever the heart that gets tired? Generally, no. The pyruvic acid and things like that, and all the other good bad things that happen in muscle tissue that makes it tired, results in that kind of muscle fatigue faster than it would in heart fatigue. However, of course, there are certain medical conditions in which this is not the case. So if intense exercise or stress or something like that befalls somebody who already has a cardiac issue, or it's taking blood pressure and pulse to levels in which it is not accustomed to, then yes, it is the heart that's going to fail. I mean, this this is kind of a heart attack thing. We'll talk about myocardial infarctions here in just a brief minute. But during people who are generally exercising, their heart would have to have a pre-existing condition in order to fail or get tired. Because the more the heart beats during exercise and is put through good amounts of exercise, it grows like a bicep or something like that, but it grows stronger and more resilient. And so this is also why people who exercise a lot have a lower heartbeat, which is also why a lot of people are saying you need to exercise more so you have a lower heartbeat, because heart rate is directly correlated with death, which, again, we just talked about, and that's not quite exactly true. But being heart healthy, of course, is a great idea for longevity. And poor health equals faster heartbeats. Again, there are different diseases that can cause that faster heart rate or even a slower heart rate, but they're not necessarily related to exercise. So don't worry about exercising. If your heart's in good condition, or what do they say for like Viagra? If you are in good heart health, you are a good candidate for Viagra. Again, another complicated question that probably deserves its own thing, but good question. But is it ever the heart that gets tired? Can be. Is it in a normal working system? No. Your muscles will give out before the heart does, and that has a lot to do with the acid buildup and things like that. But the brain has a lot to do with this too, so it'll pump in, especially if you're running from a pack of hungry wolves or something like that. Your brain is going to pump the heart even faster, or force the heart to pump, whip it into shape with wonderful things like norepinephrine, epinephrine, adrenaline, same thing. So what about heart attacks? Or let's open this up a little bit more into just general heart failure. So if your heart don't pump, you don't get blood to the brain and other organ tissues that are critical to life. So there are many, 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 many potential causes for that, but they're all very nuanced and very different. So a heart attack, for the most part, is when blood supply to the heart itself is disrupted through fat deposits, things like that. This is different than leaky valves or stiffened heart muscles. We'll talk about that in just a second. But basically, the heart needs to feed itself, right? And it does so very efficiently. It's the first blood supply that is ejected out of systemic circulation. And these are very small arteries and veins on the surface of the heart. So when you look at a diagram of the heart, you can see them quite easily. So a lot of people, you know, may think that you're having a heart attack because of one of your major vessels is blocked. That's not actually the case. It's those little tiny ones on the surface of the heart that service the heart, that if they get blocked, then that is incompatible with life. And then a heart attack is where the heart itself isn't getting the blood supply it needs, so it seizes. Parts of it die. When we're looking at things within the heart, that could be valve problems or an electrical problem, because it is an electrical system. Well, partly electrical system. It could also be the myocardial or the muscle tissue itself that has stiffened. This happens from proteins building up from blood cells that build up on the heart tissue, making the tissue stiff. And so if it's not nice and spongy and springy, then it's not giving as much blood than it should. And that results in low blood flow and then eventually failure. Valves, when they leak, also prevent blood flow going to the places it needs to, and then also increases blood pressure because the heart has to work harder than it should in order to service the tissues and everything else. Excuse the train. Once upon a time, there was light in my life. Oh, that's unexpected. Let's let it go. Nothing I can say, a total eclipse of the heart. That's nice. We would call it a total occlusion of the heart, but that was meant to be somewhere else. But you know what? I think we're going to go ahead and keep it right there. Turn around, bright eyes. Turn around. One theme of questions that we have is heartbeats themselves. What regulates heart rate? And how is that manifested in the muscle tissue itself? Well, as you've heard me say before, the heart also is an electrical system. Heart tissue, or myocardial tissue, has what's called inherent rhythmicity, which is really, really cool. So this is the heart muscle itself doesn't regulate, but it does beat at a regular interval. Even if the brain is dead, even if the electrical system is dead, this can actually be forced. Little guy named Galvani tried this with some frogs and things like that, just as far as galvanic responses and kicking legs and nervous system stuff. But basically, myocardial tissue is able to convulse and pump on its own without outside influence because of its own electrical system. Now, it can only pump at a very low level. So we're talking 20 beats per minute, which is, as they say, non-conducive with life. So there has to be another system in place in order to whip that baby into a higher rate, which would be ideally between 60 and 100, depending on, you know, if you're doing a lot of things or just not anything. That happens from the electrical system at the sinoatrial node and other little nodes and things like that. So basically, if you think of a wiring diagram going directly into the heart, the sinoatrial node is the thing that is activating the contraction of the heart muscle at a higher rate, which is influenced by a number of different factors. One of them, brain. Another one, your lymphatic system and just hormones that are going on. This is how things like adrenaline can work more locally on the heart than just the brain. And that sinoatrial node signals the ventricles, well, signals the atria and the ventricles to do their business. One of the interesting things about this electrical system is that it relies on having a very consistent distance to travel. So if you have something like an enlarged heart, that signal is going to take a little bit longer to reach the right ventricle, which is going to cause an arrhythmia. And sometimes fibrillation if it's not coordinated correctly. So defibrillator is not physically trying to pump the heart in the same way that CPR is. It's trying to reset the electrical rhythms of the heart. And this is also, we can get into EKGs, the K is because of Germans, and so on and so forth. But the main thing is that the heart muscle itself works on its own at limited function, and then is increased, the heart rate is increased by electrical stimulation and specialized cells that propagate this electrical charge to all ventricles. That's another thing that we'll just have to go into in a much greater detail at some point in order for you to fully understand what the hell that even means. But basically, important stuff is that CPR and defibrillation are not the same thing. And a defibrillator for problems of this sort is almost always crucial. You cannot... It's very rare for you to be able to fix fibrillation with CPR alone. This is one of the reasons why this last century has been so badass, is that we've been able to create technologies that are relatively cheap and in every workplace and hospital that have saved countless people's lives. So kind of a breakdown on that electrical part is what's called the sinoatrial node, which, as the name suggests, is seated on top of the atria. Then there is an AV node. Think of this really as an electrical kind of diagram. These are nodes that connect to each other and then propagate a signal. And then from that is a bundle of His, which is too much to even talk about. Kind of a telecommunications area. And then there's two branches that go from the septum. That's the very center of the heart. Look at a diagram. This will help you out quite a lot. Into a right bundle branch and a left bundle branch. The SA node begins at the normal heartbeat, by producing an electrical signal. And then the P wave represents the electrical activity of the atrium. And just ignore all that crap. So this entire electrical system is causing the heart to beat, to wrench blood. And then you want to think of the valves as something much, much, much more mechanical. It's not influenced in the same way that the rest of the myocardium is. It's reacting. And so I think one of the things I always want to talk about with a heart is that it is not a mechanical pump. It is a very dynamic structure. The things that are mechanical about it, outside of the cellular structure, you know, like the mechanical bits and pieces, the anatomy of myocardial tissue, are the valves. And the valves act with a bit of nuance, though. There are things called papillary bodies and things like that adjust the tension of the valves as heart blood flows. But the valve itself is very, it's a very physical valve. This is why these things can be replaced with mechanical, you know, synthetic valves or biological valves from piggies and humans and things like that. It's not so out of the question that that we would be getting closer and closer to non-human biological heart replacements on the whole. But we still have a little bit of time. And I think everybody needs to really understand how new heart surgery really is. We're looking at, you know, like pre-World War II sorts of advances here. And what we're capable of doing now is utterly remarkable, including just like full-on transplantations. This is something that is new to the century. And so it's still very much uncharted territory. Even though it seems as though heart surgeons are gods in some ways. I mean, I think every one of them would admit that there's still so far to go. And surgeons that are in their 60s, 70s, and 80s still remember a time in their residency in which none of this sort of repair work would be in any way possible. It's a complicated organ. It is not just a mechanical pump. It is a very, very dynamic structure and at the core of our being. It has its own mind in some ways, especially when we're looking at kind of that electrical signal that's ambient, or not ambient, but it's inherent. The brain regulates, but the heart also has a lot of say in what happens to the brain. The nervous system itself is many, many potential podcasts, but it's not as simple as a command structure in the brain going down to every organ system and then the organ systems feeding back information. In fact, when we're looking at responses to pain stimuli and things like that, your reflexes will react faster than the brain actually understands what's going on. There are particular stopgap measures in place in the nervous system to ensure that you remove your hand from the burning stove prior to your brain even being cognizant of it or pain even being registered. Remarkable system, but I would never say it's a remarkable machine. It is, as I said before, it's far more dynamic than that. La, la. So what about the culinary aspects of heart? Eat your heart out, kids. Well, let's see. I have about 40 chicken hearts thawing on the kitchen counter right now. I have a soup in the fridge that has cubed pig hearts. This Valentine's Day, I plan on making bovine hearts. Is it edible? You're damn right it's edible. Actually, when you think about it, what we've talked about with the tissue itself, there's three types of muscle tissue. There's smooth muscle, there is skeletal muscle, and there's cardiac muscle. Smooth muscle, like what's in your intestines and things like that, that kind of move food around. You don't have much control over whatsoever. Skeletal muscle, you do have a lot of control over. That's what, you know, your biceps, triceps, deltoids, all that kind of stuff is made from. And then there's myocardial, which, as I said before, is also infused with nervous tissue. But the way in which the heart pumps is because of its spongy nature. It's coiled differently. And it also doesn't really keep a lot of fat inside the tissue at all. All of that is on the outside of a heart. When you look at a heart diagram or look at a heart itself, you'll be able to notice that pretty quickly, that the fat is kept on the outside, which, you know, you shouldn't have a lot of fat in your heart. That's not a good thing. That's not the same as having fat in your arteries and veins either. So it's very spongy, very low in cholesterol. And depending on the animal you're talking about, there's a lot of different preparations that you can use to cook a heart. Pig hearts, typically, I mean, they're analogous with humans. And so I've always thought that pig hearts do taste a lot like human hearts. And bovine hearts are much wider grained and much, well, beefier. Surprise, surprise. So what do you do if you want to cook some hearts? Well, let's talk about that. All right, so we'll talk about three different preparations. These can be interchanged, basically, but I will tell you that chicken hearts, readily available, are going to be different than a beef heart, which is absolutely huge. And I've had a lot of different hearts in my day, many, many different types. We'll start small, just focusing on things that are actually readily available. So, chicken hearts are like meaty grapes. They pop when you bite into them, and they are very easy to overdo. So there's a lot of different recipes, Peruvian, you know, jerk style recipes, things like that. And actually, you know, it may sound a little bit gross to some of you, but this is a staple meat in a lot of different cultures. And the great thing is, if you're living in the Western world, or, you know, Canada, United States, it's very, very cheap to procure chicken hearts. One thing I like to do is brine the hearts, but it's not necessary. One thing that's really nice with chicken hearts is if you unload them all into like a little bowl or something like that, and let them soak in something like some sort of alcohol, like a wine is a very good option. But things like whiskey and stuff like that is also very good. Let them soak a little bit in that. You don't have to clean the fat deposits off because they just kind of aid in the final cooking. You can quarter them or split them or just leave them whole. If you leave them whole, one really nice thing to do is make a nice little shish kebab out of them, put them on some skewers, put them on a grill. They do not take a lot of time to cook. So on a grill, something like minute and a half, flip minute and a half is perfectly sufficient. They also really work well in soups. And if you've got a soup on the boil, like with your broths or, you know, vegetables and whatever else, let all that go. And then just dump them all in and turn off the heat. They'll cook themselves. Pig hearts are a little bit more tough. And they lend themselves really well to candying or you know, making something a little bit more sweet. So adding brown sugar to the mix is a really good idea. With those, I like to soak in milk, which is a, you know, typical thing that that a lot of Native Americans would do with a lot of meats, especially venison, things like that. Lactic acid will work on it, but these acids will only work on a surface level, so it's not going to penetrate. So you don't really need to leave these in a milk solution longer than a few hours. If you leave them in overnight, that's perfectly fine. It's not going to deteriorate the quality or anything like that. There are more structures that you need to worry about in a pig heart than you do with a beef or anything else, because the beef heart is very easy to clean. I typically, with all hearts, like to leave them intact because I like to make my guests dissect their meal a little bit. And so there are things like the valves and the cartilage bits of the aorta and stuff like that are not particularly edible. But it's okay to have your guests just kind of cut that out, or you cut it out yourself and amaze yourself with edible dissections. Also with chicken hearts, what I like to do is shove them full of raisins, like the left and right ventricles. You know, it only take like two or three raisins to do that, and usually the septum will split pretty easy. So maybe just like shove five of them in there, and then do a low heat kind of a bake. Same with pig, which is why I kind of put them all in the same place. Like jams and fruits and things like that really absorb well in myocardial tissue. Now, with beef, I would go with something a little bit more savory. So these hearts should kind of be split into sections and then cooked almost like you would cook a roast, but at low heat. So like bringing it up to 250, 260 degrees, something like that, over a longer time, and then putting a baste on it, you know, like some butter, something like that. But like rosemary, thyme, sage, things like that work really, really well for a cow heart. Now, you can grill that, but it's not a bad idea to just go ahead and treat it like a roast, put it in the oven over low heat. Or you can slice the stuff fairly thin and put it in a skillet and treat it that way. But I do think that the oven method's a little bit better for beef heart. But it is a very savory meat, beef is. So go ahead and treat it that way. So savory for beef, go a little bit sweeter on the pig, and do whatever the hell you want with chicken hearts. It's a really welcome addition to any Valentine's Day dinner. Also, I'd love to hear any of your questions or comments on the cooking of hearts, and we can address those in the next podcast, which will be about anatomical and geographical cartography. We have a special guest that will be joining us, thank God, because it's just me this time, and I'm lonely, for God's sake. This is terrible. Just my own voice. No witty repartee from anybody else. Ugh. So I just wanted to make sure that I got this podcast out for Valentine's Day so that all four people that listen to it can enjoy it. But we've got a new podcast we're going to say is a special guest, but I'm really quite hoping that this will be a person that is here all the time, and his name is Nate Stewart, and he is in the geography doctoral program at the University of Toronto, and we're going to be talking about mapping and naming the body as it relates to mapping and naming the other major organ system of humanity, cities. And so I do hope that you all come back for that one. He's got a weird sense of humor, which is exactly what we need, because this hasn't had a lot of humor in it. Well, I'm not saying it's Vulcan or anything like that, but yeah. So, if you have any questions about the cooking of said meats, or any additional questions about the heart, because we'll certainly be doing this again, and like I said, we'll be splitting some of these topics up into their own podcasts, so long as I can find some fucking way to make them entertaining, give me a shout-out at jeremy@meddlingwithnature.com. That is Jeremy at meddlingwithnature.com. Well, I suppose that's it for us this holiday. I look forward to hearing your comments and all that other good stuff. Until then, eat your heart out. Go on. Give your sweetie something special for Valentine's Day. Put a little bit of effort into it. Don't just go to a restaurant. Go to Jungle Gyms or your local Korean market, or No Frills here. Buy yourself some hearts. Oh, and lamb is you can treat lamb in kind of... lamb meat is its own thing. You know how to cook lamb. Just apply those skills that you've got to that. And if you feel adventurous, cat hearts are pretty good too.